All right, shall we?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Go for it.
Okay, so welcome, thanks for coming tonight. My name is Mike Morell. I'm a campaigns manager at Open Rights Group.
Hello, I'm Alex Haydock. I'm a legal officer at the Open Rights Group.
And we'll just give you a quick description of what the Open Rights Group is. You probably already know, but we're a digital campaigning organization. We work to protect basic rights that we all share, but we protect them online in the digital sphere. So a lot of times that's protecting privacy and free speech online. Tonight, in particular, we're talking about free speech. So we work to protect digital rights, and we do it in a lot of different ways. We do policy work. We also do campaigning work. That's a lot of what I do is organize the campaigns, and we work with, we have different chapters in different UK cities across the country, and we also have a legal team.
Yes.
That's what Alex works on as well. And we also do tech projects, all kinds of tech projects. We'll talk a little bit about that tonight. Mm. Some issues we've been working on recently, been really busy, of course, because of Cambridge Analytica, the Facebook scandal. The timing of it is interesting because it's coinciding with the movement of the new data protection bill. It's making its way through the House of Commons at the moment. So in a way, it's a good thing because it's bringing attention in the public mind to data protection issues. It's almost kind of like a, you know, I see it as like a miniature Edward Snowden moment. It's breaking into the mainstream consciousness. So that's, hopefully going to impact some of our campaigning in that area. And so that's just this week we've been campaigning on that. There's a consultation going on simultaneously with the data protection bill action. And then we've also been working on the EU copyright directive, which has to do with the upload filter for affecting content uploaders all throughout the EU and certainly still in the UK. And we've also lately been active in Scotland and Wales, because they're trying to introduce e-voting trials there as well. So we've been active in those areas as well. So lots going on. Tonight we're focusing though on modern threats to free speech online. And this is a very wide-ranging topic. And so for the purpose of bringing clarity, we're gonna sort of talk about it all within the realm of the what's called the Digital Charter. Have any of you heard of the Digital Charter before? So around this time last year, there were a lot of scary terrorist attacks, certainly here in Manchester and London as well. And when they happened, there was a lot of how the government responded was referring to technology. So whether it was trying to get around encryption methods with messaging apps like WhatsApp, or taking down terrorist content online. There's been a lot of talk about various measures to address sort of the dangers of technology and how they're contributing to things that are hurting society. A bit later, perhaps in response, maybe not direct response to the terrorist attacks, but the government has been publicizing its activities to make the internet safer under this sort of umbrella term, which is the Digital Charter. And this was first announced in the Queen's speech last year, I think it was in October. And then in January of this year, there was a policy paper that was published. This is about half of it right here. It's quite short. And it's a very wide-ranging program, the Digital Charter. And so its mission really is a lot like Open Rights Group, like on the face of it, actually. They want to instill the same protections online as we have offline. And so, a lot of it's definitely, got its head in the right place. And so we've been analyzing all the various things that are part of the Digital Charter. And tonight we're gonna do a brief overview of all those, of all the various initiatives that are involved. And then we're gonna focus on some problematic sections that we think pose threats, particularly to freedom of speech online. So some of the elements of within the,
Yeah, I mean, it is worth noting that the way they talked about this for months, we expected quite a fleshed out policy document, something quite in depth. And then, it's not too much hyperbole to suggest that small snippet was most of the paper. We got, in the end, once they actually published it, a a really weak two-page PDF with very vague language about what they wanted to achieve, not actually any kind of substantial policy decisions, really. So we've had to pull out what we can glean from their intentions and their methods. We've had to pull a lot of that out of other media reports that have come around at the time, other things they've announced subsequently. The actual document itself was not very helpful in that, but I'm sure we'll go through it.
That's right. So you can see these are some of the guiding principles, you know, and they're all fairly, you know, positive. Internet should be free and open. People should understand the rules. Personal data should be respected, and so on. So these are sort of the basic principles that we all pretty much agree with. And then in terms of the actual breadth of what they call like the work program within the digital charter, it covers almost anything you can think of that's online. So everything from cybersecurity and artificial intelligence to addressing disinformation or fake news, that sort of thing. And then in particular, addressing harmful, what they call harmful content online, sort of a new umbrella term, harmful content. And tonight, what we'll be talking about mainly are the sections that they're focusing on taking down harmful content online. So what I'll do is I'm just going to do a quick overview just to give you an idea. I won't focus too much on any particular part of all the major parts of the digital charter. Okay, so the first part, internet safety strategy. This has to do with protecting children online from things like bullying and other harmful content. It doesn't have anything to do with you know, terrorism, terrorist content, that sort of thing. And the principles or the goals of the internet safety strategy are to increase transparency on how social media platforms do takedowns, because right now it's hard to tell how they make decisions when they take down certain content. They also want to introduce a industry-wide levy. So they want to basically tax social media platforms and use that money to help further the internet safety strategy. They also want to increase digital literacy. They want to help kids and also parents sort of understand and be able to navigate the internet as well. And they recently had a public consultation on this open rights group. We campaigned on that. We issued a consultation response, you know, largely in support of what it's doing, but cautioning against possible abuse of how that money, the levy money, is used. This is Project Arachnid, and this is all part of their crackdown on child sexual abuse. So if you're familiar with Microsoft Photo DNA, this is a online crawler that allows that goes through the internet. It takes down offensive images, and so in this case, it has to do with like child pornography, taking down those sorts of images. Project Arachnid it uses that technology, and then it connects it to directories from authorities like Interpol, and so it allows them to, and they create sort of like a plugin that they can use on social media platforms to take down child pornography. So that's another kind of another part of the digital charter, used to protect children. Online Hate Crime Hub. This is an initiative by the police, and this is essentially, they're not investing too much money in this. I believe it's less than £1 million, but it's designed to allow when there is online hate crimes, they can be identified and then also taken down more quickly and also coordinated with local police more easily. So this is increasingly more, you know, of a problem, online hate crimes, and so it's just trying to make it so police can respond more quickly, essentially. And then, like as I mentioned, the mandate of the digital charter is so wide. What I mentioned before, these are various initiatives. They even consider the data protection bill to be technically part of the digital charter because it's focused on data protection. So as I mentioned before, we've been campaigning on this recently, and at the moment, it's right around the reporting stage. It's entering next week, so it's making its way through. This is also considered part of the digital charter. Okay. And you know, we have issues with the digital charter. We won't go into all those right now. I'm sorry, the data protection bill. Yes. And Alex is going to start talking about the problems we've identified.
Yeah, so those are some of the initiatives from the rather anemic digital charter that we've identified that aren't, you know, too problematic. They're quite hard to argue against. But there are some which are rather problematic. And those are the ones I'm going to kind of highlight today. So, as Mike mentioned, a lot of this came in the wake of various terrorist attacks, but there's been quite a few terrorist attacks over the previous years. And one of the common recurring themes is that after each one, it tends to be some form of high-ranking official will come out from the government and suggest that perhaps in some way technology was to blame. So it's often encrypted messaging, it's often social media, it's often just the internet in general was somehow responsible for this. Whether or not that's politicians trying to divert blame away from the fact that the security services had failed to stop these kinds of attacks, whether or not it's them wanting to use it as an excuse to get more control online, or whether or not it's simply them not understanding the issues, this is just something that we see time and time again. And the Digital Charter and some of the proposals that have come out referencing the Digital Charter since then is very much born out of this. So, at the moment, one of the major, major problems that we have, for especially when considering free speech and free expression, is content takedowns. So removing content from the internet. So the German situation is quite interesting. So the German parliament, or the German government rather, had issues with wanting to take down terrorist content online a couple of years ago. And they went to the major social media platforms, particularly Facebook, and they got a commitment from Facebook and these other platforms to remove this kind of broadly defined terrorist material within 24 hours of it being uploaded. So that was back in 2015. By 2017, the government was saying, well, you know, you're not doing this fast enough. Can we perhaps put something into law to actually force you to do it? So they wanted to pass through a law to make this 24-hour takedown mandatory. And they succeeded in passing through that law. That was late 2017. We haven't seen yet much of the results of that, but that's something that we're going to be pursuing quite closely and looking into it. But the interesting thing about the German situation is if you have, as a company, 24 hours to remove a piece of content, which is quite quick, but it's not too much of a problem because you can theoretically develop some kind of algorithmic system to flag the kind of content, and then a human reviewer can review pieces of content before it's removed or before it's determined that actually that content should stay. Similarly, in the 24-hour period, you don't need this kind of content takedown system to be too aggressive because you can rely on people actually reporting the content, and then again, a human reviewer can review it before it gets actually removed. Now, since then, Theresa May has decided that that's quite a good idea, but instead of proposing a 24-hour takedown, Theresa May proposed a 2-hour takedown. And obviously, this is where we get into problems, because in the German scenario, it is conceivable that you can have some kind of human intervention going on. But if you think about the sheer amount of content that's uploaded to Facebook and the sheer number of tweets that go out per minute and however many hours of video that YouTube gets uploaded per minute, a 2-hour takedown without relying basically entirely on algorithms and bots to do the actual analysis and removal of the content is close to impossible. With a 2-hour window, you're really not going to have humans being able to review the majority of content that's being removed. So this proposal of Theresa May's, you know, it's backed, the idea is it would be placed into legislation, it would be backed by fines if the social media companies fail to meet this 2-hour goal. And that's where we start to see a real problem, and that's where all get quite concerned, is this idea of fines. So at this point, not only do you have this incentive for takedowns to happen not using humans who understand context and nuance and humor and that sort of thing, so you've got this idea that basically bots are going to be doing it. Not only do you have that, but once you've introduced the fines, you have an economic incentive to basically take down as much content as possible if there's any kind of gray area involved. So if it's content that could go either way in terms of definition, and this is another problem I'll get onto, is definitions of what actually is terrorist content or extremist content. If a social media company is kind of on the fence about a piece of content, it's going to get taken down, basically, because they have to protect themselves from these fines, so they're going to have to basically overblock. And that does lead to quite serious chilling effects when you think about what kinds of content people are going to be posting, what kinds of content people are going to want to read. And of course, it's not just a human erring on the side of caution either. It's they're going to write these bots and algorithms in such a way that they're very, very overzealous in terms of what they take down. So that is a huge problem for us, especially the chilling effect that comes in the wake of it, and especially the fines that are basically creating this economic incentive for censorship. So a couple of months ago, January, I think, I don't know if you remember, Amber Rudd announced this AI-based system that could reliably identify terrorist videos. It was reliably identify ISIS propaganda videos, I think it was. And they presented this using some quite interesting statistics, which I think were something like, it's 96% accurate 99% of the time, or 99% accurate 96% of the time. I don't know, which I find a really strange way of presenting a statistic on accuracy. But for sake of argument, even if we think of it as, let's give them the benefit of the doubt and say it's 99% accurate. If we go back to this idea of how many hours of video YouTube gets uploaded per minute, how many tweets go out per minute, this idea of a 1% error ratio becomes huge when you're talking about the scale of the internet. So if this automated system looks over 100,000 pieces of content, depending on how you've programmed it, it's going to react to that content. And either it's gonna, well, let's say it's taking down 100,000 pieces of content. Depending on how you've programmed it, that's either gonna be 1,000 videos that weren't ISIS propaganda that got taken down, which is an immense problem for free expression, or that's gonna be 1,000 ISIS videos that slip through the net, in which case the system's not really working anyway. And it's hard to defend something that's such a derogation to the right of free expression when it's quite clear that it's not fully working and it's letting through so much problematic content. So those are two proposals that come in the wake of this German one. Something that is actually currently going on involves a body called Satiru. Now, has anyone heard of Satiru? No, I would have been surprised. So Satiru are the Counterterrorism Internet Referrals Unit. They're actually a sub-unit of the Metropolitan Police. And I'm not surprised nobody's heard of them because they're quite quiet about what they do. Satiru release, aside from a couple of sentences here and there, they release a single statistic about what they do. And that is that I think as of 20... Actually, I do have the statistic. As of the 26th of March this year, their single statistic they released says they took 304,569 pieces of terrorist content off the internet since they started 5 years ago, I believe it was. So at Org, we obviously found that's an immensely problematic statistic, because what does that even mean? 300,000 pieces of content could be 300,000 individually produced propaganda videos, it could be 300,000 different blog posts, it could be 30,000 tweets, you know, reposted by 10,000 bots. And then once you start thinking about that, you start thinking about, well, what's the reach of this content? Because if there's 10,000 bots posting it, or even 30,000 bots posting 10,000 pieces of content, is anyone actually, you know, following these bots? Does anyone actually see this content? You know, what is the reach? So we wanted to get a bit more information about how they work, so we tried submitting freedom of information requests to them for a bit more info on, can we have possibly more than one single statistic, and possibly could you explain what it is you actually do and how you do it? But the sad thing about the freedom of information request, or the Freedom of Information Act, is that there are a number of reasons
a number of sort of defenses to having to actually reply with any of the information that someone requests. And one of the notable ones is national security. So we've submitted to them a bunch of requests basically asking, can we have some more statistics, maybe some more detailed statistics? We've even tried just asking for lists of the internal statistics that we do keep, that they do keep, so that we know what to ask for. But they've basically blanket denied all of our requests so far, saying national security. Nope, sorry, national security. You can't have any of these statistics that we keep. So very interestingly, we got locked in a several month battle with them. Probably 4 or 5 months they've been telling us in response to a request where we asked for literally just a list of the internal statistics they keep for kind of performance analysis and analyzing how well this scheme of taking down content is doing. We asked for literally just a list of the statistics that they keep. For about 4 or 5 months, they just said, nope, nope, national security, nope. They denied all of our appeals, internal reviews. And the next stage from there, in terms of the Freedom of Information Act, is to apply or appeal to the ICO, who are the Information Commissioner's Office, and get them to investigate. So we get this third-party information commissioner involved. And suddenly, after they got involved, we got a response after 5 months that actually said, oh, actually, sorry, we've reviewed your request and we don't keep any internal statistics. Which we thought was a bit, firstly, confusing. Secondly, a little hard to believe. And thirdly, even if we do believe it, and we have kind of submitted further requests to find out whether in fact that's true, because there is something suspect going on there. But even if we do consider that to be true, and they don't keep any internal statistics, that's immensely worrying, because that means there's basically no performance review going on here for this department. They're taking down content from the internet without any kind of oversight, without any kind of internal analysis even of whether or not it's effective. There's no kind of statistics being generated at all about what the content is that they're removing. So in terms of even just in terms of a body that's accepting public funding, they aren't able to say whether or not they're reliable or whether or not they're actually doing anything good and worthwhile. All they can come out with is this one single statistic. So we're carrying on the freedom of information fight there. We're going to see where we go with that. But it's one of the major interesting factors at play in terms of the content takedown landscape. The major problems we have with all of these in common is overblocking. So top three are clear examples of overblocking. Soteria might be an example of overblocking, but they clearly don't keep statistics, as so they tell us, so we don't actually know. And the other problem is, in all of these, we haven't really seen any proposals for transparency or notification. And this, from a free expression perspective, is a huge problem, because one of the things that should really be guaranteed to citizens along with the freedom of expression is this right, this idea of a right to redress. So if your expression is impinged upon, if your content is removed, you should be made aware of that so you can appeal, or if necessary, you can challenge it in court. You know, you should be given some way of challenging this. And what we found is that with all of these, there's not really any notification happening when content is blocked. And in the ones that are proposals, there's not really any notifications planned. So there's not necessarily any system whereby if your tweet or website or whatever gets removed by Soteria, and we're certainly not aware of it at least, there's no system whereby you're actually made aware of that. Your content, your blog post might just disappear one day, and you would have no idea why. You probably haven't heard of Soteria, and you're probably not aware that effectively the police removed your content. That's a huge problem for the right to redress. And indeed, if the public aren't being sufficiently informed about how this blogging works, that's a major accountability issue as well. So if these are public bodies like Soteria, or if these are effectively government proposals and we don't actually know what they're doing fully, transparently, and how they're operating, from an accountability perspective, that's another huge problem. So I'll quickly go over our main points here. We're against the use of fines in any term, any kind of content takedown, because, as I say, that's where you get the economic incentive to remove as much as possible. We're against fast takedowns, because that's where you get the incentive to use bots and not humans who actually understand the content and the nuances involved. And if blocking must be used, it must be prescribed by law. So Satira is quite interesting because they're not actually, in terms of content takedowns, they're not submitting any kind of court request. They're not really submitting anything legally formal or binding on behalf of the government. What they're actually doing is they're basically going to companies and saying, you know, dear Facebook, you have this piece of terrorist content on your platform. We are the police. Can you remove it? And they're effectively, as far as we can see, hoping for compliance at that point. So they're not submitting court orders and that sort of thing, which is an interesting way of sidestepping the idea of judicial oversight. In quite an interesting way, because technically their requests wouldn't be mandatory to be complied with, but what we're seeing is presumably, given that they have some level of success that they're touting with this single figure that they have, presumably these social media companies and the other companies are actually complying with the requests anyway. So yeah, that's a definite problem from the accountability and transparency perspective.
Great. So much of our concern about these filters is based on the concept that, you know, artificial intelligence cannot grasp context. It can't grasp the finer points of freedom of speech when someone's talking about terrorist propaganda in an academic journal or in an article versus actual propaganda. And so, you know, we're concerned that these machines will overblock because they can't tell the difference. And to some people, that might sound like, oh, would that really happen? What's the chance of that? Is that really going to be a big problem? Like, how many articles are written that would actually get pulled down? And, you know, I don't think it would be that bad. Well, as I mentioned earlier, Open Rights Group does tech projects. And one of our oldest and longest going tech projects is essentially a censorship detection tool. It's called Blocked. URL is blocked.org.uk. And so, not to confuse matters, first of all, I'll make a distinction. The algorithms we were talking about before, the proposals we're talking about, these are proposals that will apply to platforms like Facebook, like YouTube, popular platforms. Blocked works on different kind of filters. It works on default ISP, Internet Service Provider filters. So it's this different network. It's a bigger network, but it's not exactly the same. The commonality is it's about filters. So what does Blocked do? This website, this tool, allows you to type in any website, and it'll instantly tell you if that site is being blocked by any ISP in the UK. We're currently expanding into the EU and other countries as well. And it's something we're constantly working on. At this point, once it identifies which ISPs are blocking it, you can, with a click of a button, you can request that it get unblocked. And so what it does is it documents all the blocks that happen, and we've identified many wrongful blocks. And it's quite interesting what happens, because after a while, we've seen patterns within the wrongful blocks. And so what we find is the patterns, they do reveal that an algorithm's inability to grasp context. So for example, so these default blocks, these are internet filters that are on automatically on your phone or on your home internet that you can turn off if you want to, but a lot of people don't know they're on. And they're currently on right now for, I think it's about 3.5 million people, or quite a few million people.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah. Right, exactly. And so they're meant to protect kids, essentially. So a lot of the categories are like adult content or violence or drugs, things like that. So it's really interesting when you see the patterns of sort of the collateral damage of those categories, those tags. So along with a lot of things that are correctly blocked, such as pornography websites or drug websites, whatever.
Yeah, stuff that actually fits into the category.
Right. Along with that, we find there's a lot of, for example, a lot of sexual abuse counseling websites that get blocked, or a lot of drug rehabilitation sites, or sites where they
suicide helplines,
where they use those terms. And then also, an establishment like a pub will get blocked under an alcohol tag, you know, and it's like, it could be like a neighborhood.
The filters really hate alcohol for some reason.
Right, and that's fine, but it just seems like surely that wasn't their intention. And the truth is, when you use the tool and you request an unblock and you explain to them, and you're like, oh, hey, I think this was blocked by mistake. They're, you know, most of the time they're like, oh, you're right, sorry, and they unblock it. And so we've been documenting also a lot of sites we've unblocked as well. But it really clearly illustrates that this is an actual real problem. And then, of course, there are stories. There are websites that are just completely, almost randomly blocked, it seems like a watch seller, for example, or a car dealership or something, that's getting blocked along with, like, a blog about, like, war in Syria that got blocked by mistake somehow. So that's your proof right there that this is a problem, actually. And, to compare it to, I like to think about, like, some other technologies that we're, you know, starting to rapidly embrace or just assume that are okay. A few weeks ago, there was a notable death of one of the first or second death of an autonomous car. Had an accident. You know, it was in the news, and the whole world knew about it when it happened. And the programs were, you know, put on hold and reviewed everywhere, all over the place. Well, you know, this technology, this blocking technology, is being, it's not killing people necessarily, but it has the potential to curb our free speech, and it's being rolled out there is a lot of collateral damage, and yet for some reason it's not held to the same standard. People aren't aware of it.
Yeah. So these filters obviously are the ones that just the standard adult content filters, which are. They're legal because you can turn them off. Otherwise, there would be a violation of the e-commerce directive and a bunch of other, the right to free speech, the right to free expression in the European Convention on Human Rights as well. But they're legal basically because you can turn them off. But the thing is, the fact that a lot of people don't turn them off means that the people who run the sites, which have been wrongly blocked, can end up in a situation where they're losing viewers, and they don't know why, because they don't know their site's blocked. So this perfectly demonstrates our problems with transparency. Because as Mike says, when you find a website that's ridiculously blocked and you request that the ISPs have a look at it and say, hang on, I don't really think this should be in your adult content filter, then, yeah, generally they will look at it and go, oh, yeah, fair enough, and they'll comply and it'll be unblocked. But it took us to actually build the transparency tool that goes and finds what websites are blocked before that could happen. So without that, without this tool, these people who run the sites that were blocked would have no idea, and they would have no recourse. And in this case, the recourse is that because these filters are adult content filters and the ISPs only intend them to attack adult content, the recourse is that if the site doesn't really fit within that, it will be unblocked. But if we've got Satiru doing takedowns of individual pieces of content, if we've got social media sites doing takedowns of individual pieces of content, you know, within 2 hours, we're going to reach a situation where there will be no transparency and there will be no tool like this. So people who've had their content removed firstly won't know and won't have any form of recourse. But I would definitely recommend people check out Blocked. A lot of the stupidest blocks have been removed by now because people have spotted them through our tool and requested them. And I think my personal favorite and one that puzzled us in the office for a while was why so many concrete merchants had their sites blocked. And I don't know if anyone wants to take a guess. Nope. We puzzled it for months and we kind of discovered that perhaps it's because a lot of them use the word hardcore repeatedly. So all these concrete merchants probably rightfully did not expect that their sites might be blocked by adult content filters. And you got to remember that this is not just kids that have these on, this is just people's general home filters. So if you want to go and buy concrete and the site's blocked, well, you're not going to buy concrete, you're just going to go and find another site. So these people could be losing business and that sort of thing. And that's bad, but in terms of free expression in terms of the terrorist content issue, it's potentially even worse because it's their actual raw content, their actual speech is being directly taken down and directly removed from platforms. So that is a big worry. So one of the other things that's kind of come out of this whole digital charter discussion is the extension of the currently existing stuff within the law that's mostly, I believe, in the Terrorism Act, which criminalizes viewing terrorist content. So there's proposals at the moment to increase the sentence for viewing terrorist content from 10 to 15 years, which is already excessive, but it's becoming even more excessive. And within the proposals and within even the current terrorism acts, there's a very unclear definition of what amounts to terrorist material, what amounts to extremist material. This is a definition which varies between basically everyone that you ask. There's not even an international consensus on it. There's certainly not a consensus between platforms like Facebook and YouTube and that sort of thing on what kind of content they will and won't remove. And there's also no real defined notion of what repeated viewing is. So this doesn't criminalize the incidental viewing of, you know, one ISIS video or whatever. It criminalizes repeated viewing. But what does that mean? Does that mean twice? Does that mean, you know, if your browser kept the tab open and you reopened it, does that mean now you're a terrorist? Or does it mean that you have to actively engage with a lot of the content, a lot of different varied content? We don't really know because it's not fully defined. Which is a major problem. Obviously, this kind of thing is going to lead to the criminalization, effectively, of legitimate research. It's going to lead to the criminalization of journalism. It's going to lead to problems for campaigners. So people who need to engage with this content to do their jobs, but who aren't necessarily becoming radicalized by it. So if your job is to study radicalization, as these people's job might be, and you can't do that, then, well, or you can't do that without being labeled a radical, then we have, you know, we start to have free expression problems. There's an interesting anecdote related to that, which is following the revelations about PRISM and that sort of thing from Edward Snowden, Wikimedia publish open statistics on page views for Wikipedia articles. And someone went through and kind of analyzed and discovered that after the whole PRISM thing, you know, was brought into public consciousness, page views on articles like Al-Qaeda and nitroglycerin and that sort of thing dropped quite dramatically, simply because there's this chilling effect in that people are afraid to read. You're now aware of the fact that you're being watched, perhaps, in terms of what you do, and people were afraid to engage with this kind of content. In that case, obviously, Wikipedia has HTTPS, so it wouldn't have mattered anyway. But you get the idea from a sort of a criminalization causing these issues. And of course, yes, the idea of removing all this content can actually, you know, so some of the academic research in this area, obviously, it's inconclusive. It's difficult to study ethically. But in terms of radicalization, removing all the content that supposedly will radicalize someone actually can, you know, in some academics' views, feed into the radicalization because it feeds this idea of it being you versus the state. You want to view this content that aligns with your worldview, and the state keeps removing it. And if the content that aligns with your worldview is largely anti-state, and they keep kind of proving your point that they're the enemy, then there's some argument to be made that actually all of this simply feeds this idea and feeds into the radicalization and doesn't actually solve the problem it's setting out to solve.
All the problems we've identified so far have been very concrete. We're against the fines for the fast takedowns. We're against the criminalization of viewing and the harsh increased penalties. And so the last point we're going to make about sort of our critique of a digital charter is more structural. And this is just the general transfer of authority to internet companies from the government. So As I mentioned, digital charter is very, very wide and encompassing. And the government actually states in the charter that it's not just a government thing. They're actively encouraging and hoping, you know, industry to lead the way in a lot of these matters. And these companies, particularly major social media platforms, are rising to the challenge, and they're in many ways, they really are leading the way in a way that the government isn't. And we see that as a problem, because what used to be something like a walled garden like Facebook had a concept that it wasn't quite so big, but now they're getting so huge that these companies are actually starting to have the power to control what people say and do online in a way that they never really were supposed to. And so if anyone's going to regulate free speech, it's got to be the government can be really the only entity that can have the authority to do that. And we're concerned that they may be in their sort of enthusiasm to have these companies tackle these issues, they might be losing some of their authority and giving it to these giant companies. So part of Alex, what he said about issues with criminalizing viewership has to do with poor definitions. And that goes to the heart of this as well. So there exists definitions for hate speech or extremist content offline, terrorist content. Those are notoriously difficult concepts to define, but there are legal definitions for those things offline. Online, they have yet to come for streaming content and things like that. There's a lot that's unclear. And so you'll see in terms of services of different platforms, they'll sort of spell out what they consider to be acceptable content. And what's happening now is there's a lot of ambiguity. There's a lot of, it's just very unclear. Terms like harmful content are sort of encompassing everything from bullying to terrorism and everything in between. And it's all a bit fuzzy. And our recommendation is, what we want is actually quite simple. We just want the government to be accountable by defining czar. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot to mention, these are some examples of some of the sort of initiatives that social media companies are doing internationally within the country. Microsoft, YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook are part of the Global Internet Forum to Counter Terrorism. So, these companies are really running with it. This is infographic done by Article 19, the organization Article 19, nonprofit organization. And this is a tiered diagram of what constitutes hate speech, with sort of must be protected, lawful hate speech at the bottom, and going to the very top being like the worst kind of inciting genocide the worst kind of hate speech you could possibly imagine. We'd like the government to legislate to define clear definition of hate speech, and then also a separate definition for extremist content. That's what we think is the best model, because these are tricky terms. It's got to be a graded definition.
What's lawful hate speech? That would be saying something that's hateful in nature, perhaps offensive, tasteless, that sort of thing, but that's generally protected because it's not a direct incitement to violence or a direct threat.
Something that, like, you sort of say, well, I don't like that group or whatever, but you're not saying you're
exactly that, yeah. The main thing we're getting at here is that we want there to be very clearly defined sort of, very clearly defined lines of what must be protected under free expression, what, maybe starting to get into the restricted realm, and then what must be restricted. Because at the moment we just have a very amorphous mess of, we don't really know, is this or is this not hate speech. Hate speech is another one of those things, like terrorist content, where there are a number of different definitions. They all kind of disagree with each other, and it seems to be different offline and online. The hate speech in terms of the Public Order Act is different to things that are applied by, for instance, Section 127 of the Communications Act. And there is also a different act in Scotland, which is very similar and also defines hate speech, but more narrowly. And so basically, the idea that hate speech can be different
or rather, the idea that the hatefulness of speech can be different when it's online and offline, or whether you're in Scotland, is an immense problem for us. So we want something that's clear, kind of like this.
Yeah, exactly. And yeah, and it's to be fair also to the platforms, because in their terms and services and whatnot, they're all just deciding what, you know, and each one's a little bit different of what's acceptable content, what's not acceptable content. We want the government, it's really about accountability, because by legislating with clear definitions, they'll set, you know, sort of a baseline that everyone else can operate by.
I can sort of talk about the legislative approach here, and that the concern with a lot of these initiatives that have been proposed is that the government might attempt to do this without legislation. And in terms of free expression, we obviously, you know, we understand our right to free expression as actionable against the government. So, you know, you have a right to speak freely in the sense that the government or the state is not allowed to decide what you can and can't say, outside of the obvious sort of lawful exceptions that are put in place in law. That does not protect you on a private platform like Facebook. So Facebook can remove whatever content you post according to their own arbitrary rules. You don't have any kind of free expression defense in law to that. You can't say, hey, they removed this photo of mine, I'm gonna go to some human rights court about this. No. The concern we have, though, is that the government is effectively instituting these schemes as, you know, schemes born of the government, of the state. But because they're doing it in a kind of colloquial agreement sort of way with the social media companies, these schemes aren't really something that's protected by this whole legal right to free expression. Because if the government has a colloquial sort of argument with, with Facebook to say, Facebook, can you please remove terrorist content when you see it? And Facebook gets to define terrorist content, Facebook does all the removal, you still don't have any right of recourse in terms of a human rights kind of action against the state, because there is no kind of legal relationship in place here. The state is not really ordering specific pieces of content to be removed. In some cases, like the example of Satiru, they're requesting that perhaps the social media platform will comply, but what they're basically doing is sidestepping this whole human rights argument by just creating this kind of informal agreement with Facebook that when Facebook sees hate speech, they'll take it down. But then they're kind of deliberately not defining hate speech and all these other sorts of things, because then they're not caught up in this whole human rights mess. And if they get caught up in the human rights mess, it's quite possible that they'll get told that, in fact, they can't do what they want to do. So that's probably why, we would imagine. Yes.
Okay, so finally, what you can do about all this. So we do have a petition. We have it with us. I encourage you to sign it. It has, you know, three major sections. One's about the fines and the fast takedowns. One's about the criminalization of viewing, our opposition to it. And then one is about what he was just talking about the transfer of authority to these internet companies and wanting the government to take responsibility. So I encourage you to sign that. It's also a good time to talk to your MP, before all this becomes legislation.
Yeah.
Finally, I recommend, if you haven't tried Blocked, check it out. Type in your own website, see if they're blocked. And then also, we're always looking for people to run probes. So it's quite simple to run probes. We can give you one. We have all the UK ISP networks covered currently.
The major ones, yeah.
But it's always nice. It's good for us to have extra probes running to make the network more robust. Also, if you know people outside of the country in other countries who could take the probes, we're sort of expanding.
Yeah.
So
it's especially interesting if you have a niche or esoteric ISP. That would be really useful to us, because the way the probes work is you plug them in, and they test these sites on behalf of the tool, and we have them on each kind of network. But like Mike says, we have all the major ones, but if there are anybody has any sort of smaller ISPs, we're definitely interested in getting them involved in the tool as well.
Right. And then also, you can become an org member to help support our work if you're not already an org member, which just requires a regular donation to Open Rights Group. Talk to me afterwards if you'd like to do that.